Sports.
You're rocking with the bigs.
You already know.
Chicago Sports.
Baez out of the deep left center.
What's good, everybody out there? It's the Bigs TV checking in with you live. I'm here at Wrigley Field for this episode of 5 Minutes With. Today, our special guest is none other than my boy JHey, Jason Heyward.
Yo, what's up, everybody? How we doing?
How you feeling today, my brother?
Good, bro. How you doing?
Man, I can't complain, man. Another day at the ballpark. I never take being at Wrigley for granted, man.
Absolutely. Never take it for granted. Beautiful day. Fall weather starting to make its way in. But we got a lot of baseball left. Looking forward to it.
I was going to say, man, coming down the stretch the last 25 games, you guys are fighting for a wild card. Definitely trying to win the division. We got the Cardinals up three games now, right? Three games. Man, how challenging has this season been versus any of the prior ones?
I mean, every season's different. Every season's challenging in its own way. I would say the biggest thing for us this year is we've had a lot of pieces, you know, get injured or someone had to go on the IL and recover. That's a testament to how much postseason baseball we've been playing the last few years, but also just like we talked about, how tough the schedule is this year. But that's the nature of the beast, man. And you got to keep trying to piece it together, keep trying to stay afloat, and make a push this last month. But regardless, bro, it'll be nice to get most of our boys back together. We get Wilson Contreras back in there tonight.
Right.
We just had you. He needed to miss a start. Obviously, he threw well for us in August. But we need him to keep feeling good as far as his arm goes and go out there and be confident in that. So sometimes dudes are going to take a break. You know, sometimes it's going to happen and it's going to feel like it needs to reset things. But right now with these September call-ups we got, which are, everyone has been here already this year.
True.
Everyone has already contributed to this season that we've got going on, man. I really like the vibe. I really like the energy. I like how much fun we can have this year with this challenge.
A lot has been made about that leadoff spot ever since Dex left and went to St. Louis. There's been a lot of scrutiny, you know, about that leadoff spot. You took a little time. You got a little time at the leadoff spot. Can you explain to the people out there that really don't know the difference in your approach at the leadoff spot versus hitting anywhere else in the lineup?
Well, honestly, I wouldn't even say you choose to have a different approach. You get that first at bat, of course, of the game, you're the first one to go up there and face that pitcher, first one to see how the ball is coming out of his hand and whatnot. But also, the game dictates a lot for each position in the lineup. And for the most part, most spots, you can kind of let the game come to you. But batting leadoff, there's a lot of at-bats without a runner on base. There's a lot of at-bats where there's two outs coming up, so either you get a hit in a big moment or you get nothing. No positive result. So it's a mentally tough one when you talk about going out there, wanting to see a result happen, wanting to come through for your team. But, it takes time for anyone to adjust to it, and the people that go out there and get it done, there's got to be a lot of respect had for leadoff hitters to get that job done. But honestly, one of the things I noticed the most is how little time you have throughout your day when you get ready, because you get ready to go out here and play outfield, right? Whatever it is. As soon as you come off the field, boom, you go hit. Your bat's coming around like that throughout the game, like that, like that, like that. So when you're not used to setting certain time aside or forcing the issue with time and you're not picky with it, you realize, okay, wait a minute, like I got to start doing some things differently timing wise. I need to be here earlier, this much earlier, get this done earlier just to get ready for how your day's going to be, because it goes by like that. But it's honestly, man, hitting in front of this lineup, these dudes, like it's pretty dope. We got some dudes that can do a lot of special things, obviously, offensively. But, it is what it is. And I feel like some teams don't have a set guy, and teams have a lot of success with that. But, it's definitely fair to say since Dex has been gone, we haven't had one person sit up there. And that's, it's hard to do. It's hard to replace that.
No, that is, like you just said, that is, I look around the league now, and like back in the day when we were coming up, it was like that specific leadoff hitter who can bunt or steal bases or like things like that. It's not that prevalent anymore.
Right.
That's real. That's real talk. When Cubs history is mentioned, 2016 World Series, the first thing that they bring up all the time, at least 90% of the time, is the infamous JHey pep talk. during the rain delay.
Okay.
Urban legend is there was more to it than just the Jason Heyward pep talk. It's the Bigs TV. You know, we keep it real over there, but what was the pep talk like? If that's what it was, what was the pep talk?
I mean, I don't even know if it's
really a pep
talk. You call it pep talk. Okay. I would just say it's real talk.
Yeah, right.
You know, keeping it real. No wasted energy, nothing like that. Like, hey, like, this stuff needs to be said, for all of us. Everyone in that room, we all needed to hear that. We all needed to hear it together. We all need to feel each other's vibe together, slow the moment down, and just take a second to remember, like, where we are,
right?
What we done, how we got here. Yeah, like, a lot of it was pretty. It wasn't all pretty, though.
Right.
You gotta remember that part, the stuff that we overcame to get to that point. Yeah, like, the record showed we took care of business, but we overcame a lot of challenges starting from day one of spring training. Shoot, if you want to say anything, day one of the offseason, when, you know, Zobrist signs, I sign, they immediately say, hey, Cubs are going to win the World Series and shit. They're the ones picked to. So to go do that, after you're picked to do that, on top of 108 years, on top of being down 3-1, on top of playing another team who's hungry and having an outstanding season, man, that's a lot to be said about what we had to overcome to get to that point. So just remember how dope we were.
Damn, man. Do you feel like teams come, since you guys won that series in 16, do you feel like teams come in more prepared and more ready to knock y'all? I mean, it's been a couple years since y'all won it, but do you think the teams come in with...
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that vibe is something we earned. You know, that's a part of it. No, this is already a great place to play. It's already a dope atmosphere, dope city. Of course, it goes without saying, but when you have a team playing well in here and we get the kind of attention that we earn, bro, you're going to have people gunning for you every day.
Right.
You're going to get everyone's A game, and as it should be. And you should want teams to feel like they need to go through you to get to where they want to be. And that's what we had to do on the way to our situation. And that's what you're always going to have to do. But the more you earn as far as respect and the more you win, the more people are going to want to knock you off.
Real shit, man. Now, for me, growing up in Chicago, coming up in the 80s, it was important for me, going back to like the 69 Cubs, and they had Ernie Banks, Billy Williams, Fergie Jenkins, and then even in the 80s with me, I got the chance to meet Lee Smith the other day, and it was crazy, man. But you know, seeing a guy like Lee Smith and then watching those Cubs with guys like Sean Dunston, Leon Durham, Jerome Walton, and black players like that. I know you grew up in Atlanta, man. Same thing, Marquise Grissom, Ron Gant,
yeah.
Dion,
Dave Justice,
Terry Pendleton.
Kenny Lofton came through. Some names, Michael Turner, Fred McGriff. Yeah.
That made me,
Sheffield came
through. There you go.
Yeah.
You can keep on going. But for me, it was important to see black players like that to make me know that I could do it. And I was telling Lee Smith, like, guys like him, Dave Stewart, Dwight Gooden,
right,
when I saw them on the mound, it made me feel like I could go out there and do that. And that's why I was successful up into the D1 level as a pitcher. So how important was that same thing to you growing up in Atlanta, seeing guys like that?
Well, man, honestly, it started before I even set foot on the baseball field, before I really even got into watching baseball. My pops wanted to get me into baseball because of Doc Gooden, Daryl Strawberry with the Mets.
Right.
I was born in Jersey in 89. My mom's from Queens, Jamaica.
Oh,
my pops
are
from South Carolina, but my parents met in New Hampshire at school at Dartmouth.
Wow.
So my dad was working for ITT up in Newark headquarters. So around that time, we were living up there. My parents were living up there. 86 Mets, you know, they had their season, they had their run. And my pops was like, he liked baseball in high school, but he was like, I want my son to have this opportunity. So you talk about African American players. I think it was Mookie Wilson on that Mets team.
Yeah.
So just having some people on that stage up there in that city for my pops was like, hey, it's an opportunity to kind of show my son this when he comes around. You know, that was 86. I was born in 89.
Man, that's crazy.
You know, so baseball and seeing those three dudes, that group of people playing baseball in New York, gave my pops that idea. I want to introduce my son to baseball when it comes. And then Hank Aaron, you know, in Atlanta, then having the Olympics there in 96, seeing Muhammad Ali at Turner Field, at Raiders Stadium, you know, like the torch and seeing the Brett McGriffs, you already said Kenny Loftons, Sheffields. Go play baseball, bro. You know, you see people like yourself doing it. Go have fun with it. Atlanta was great, you know, 90s.
Man.
They had so many people come through there and play great baseball, won a lot of divisions, got to see them win a World Series in 95.
Yeah.
So it was definitely something that influenced my pops, then influenced me.
The walk-up music.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's one of the good things that kind of gives MLB their flavor versus the NFL and NBA. When I'm up in the press box, I mean, we talk about music here and there, mm-hmm. but when I'm up in the press box, I can't really hear what songs you come out to. So what? I know you got a few of them. What's your choices?
Right now, currently, four songs in rotation. First to Bat, Hot Shower, Chance.
Chano.
312. Second song is Atlanta. It's Young Thug with Baby. That's gonna be out there today. Bad, bad, bad. Off So Much Fun, Thugger's new album.
Okay.
I had Hot on there as well with Gunna. The last few days as well off the same album, So Much Fun. That's a dope album representing Atlanta. Third song is 03 Bonnie and Clyde.
I do hit a hole.
Yeah. So you get to mix in like sentimental with like turn up with this stuff. And then the last one is Como Antes by Bad Bunny. And that's another like love song, keeping it real, but not the same as before, is how that goes. Got a good vibe, good beat, it's chill, but it also gives you some pep. But the fans hear it, and that's what's dope, just to interact with them.
Right.
You can just hear it like, kind of slightly in the background when they gradually like started like, hey. So it's cool, it is fun. I feel like Wrigley and Dodger Stadium probably do it the best with the walkouts to get the fans involved.
Yeah, it's electric here, man, when you come out. I still think Schwarber has the edge with that classic Bone Thugs and Harmony. I did a poll about who had the best walk-up music, and Schwarbs, he had like 60% of the votes. That Bone Thugs sounds too ill up in that press box coming out to speak.
I feel it. And it's consistent. He keeps his the same, so you ain't never missing that one. You hear that Thuggish Ruggish, you're like, yes, sir, number 12.
Low-key, I'm kind of happy Chris Bryant got rid of that warm it up Chris.
It was hard for a little bit.
It
was hard for a little bit, but I feel like at the same time, you know, we all evolved, and I feel like he felt the same way. He evolved past the, you know, Chris Cross to let's get some more vibe yourself, something different. But I feel like, honestly, I feel like KB can go a little harder. I'm just saying, but he can, because he's dope. So I feel like he can go a little harder with some walkout music. But
come on, KB.
But you gotta go with what you like.
Okay.
Gotta go with your vibe.
One more thing, man, you can get up out of here. I know you're a huge social media guy. Maybe not huge, but yeah, I see you on Instagram.
I'm about to say, I'm in between.
Okay.
I'm in between.
Okay. Man, you know, this generation, social media is basically everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, most of it is good, but some of it is like, you know, you get your news, you get your information, mm-hmm. your sports and all of that. Man, how much do you pay attention to, like, the outside world about JHey, whether it's, again, scrutiny about, man, he make all this money, he don't deserve it, or whether it's praise, like, 5 gold gloves, and, you know, how much do you pay attention to the outside noise?
Honestly, bro, like, I don't have time to pay attention to what someone's saying about me like that on the social media or whatever, because it really doesn't matter.
True.
First of all.
True.
And I mean, I feel like we've all dealt with jealousy or whatever it is, or people's opinions before. Like, everyone's got their right to make an opinion.
True.
That's fine, but nobody's been through what I've been through. I haven't been through what they've been through.
True.
So I'm not gonna knock it, what they think or what they feel, but come in my shoes, you couldn't do it.
Now tell me, say it again.
You couldn't do it, come in my shoes. So it's just, for me, social media, I try to like just keep it real on there. Influence, impact, have fun. I keep up with my family on there, keep up. And also, man, like, I just feel like it's just dope that, being from Atlanta, Georgia, being African American, like, I can kind of show people, like, you know, how I'm living my mindset, how I interact with my family, with my friends, with my teammates, and just show love that way. You know, I mean, not every day you get to say what Javi Baez, like coming from Puerto Rico, being first generation of his family or first generation from that area, bro. Like multiple dudes. Like that's why you see a lot of people celebrate where they're from. Man. Like no one's done this like they've done it before. So it's just good to represent in a positive way. Good to represent and be a role model, but it's also good to represent and keep it real. Like it's not all easy. You gotta show people the real deal.
Man, like my man Bruce Lee said here, no need to worry about them, man. The haters gonna hate you. You keep doing your thing. And everybody, all the comments I see, JHey is the man. Tell JHey we love him. And man, you've been, in my opinion, doing your thing, man. I don't really listen to the outsiders. Cause like you say, I try to explain to people, you couldn't do it. Like y'all make it. I was talking to Kyle Hendricks earlier, and I was just telling him how easy you guys, like Javier Short, he makes those difficult plays look immensely routine. Same with you. I'm tracking them balls down and shading the sun and all of that. So
I appreciate it, bro. No, I appreciate it. But the love is real. It's mutual. But also, y'all, if it's not love, hey, I understand that too. You got to do what you got to do, whatever you feel. But just, I wouldn't waste that on me or the next person, man. Like, be positive. Keep moving forward.
Hey, man. It's the Bigs TV. Official, JHey is the Big certified. Always got a touchdown with the brothers. Like he said, there's not many of us around here. So it's important that we lock in with each other and get to show people the real side. And that's how we get out, man. So I appreciate you taking your time, man. We talked about it for a minute. You made it happen, and I appreciate it. And I know the people on the other side of the camera appreciate it.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you giving me the opportunity, bro. Thank you.
Love, my boy.
Yes, sir.
All right. Appreciate you, man.
Good luck.
Hey, man, that's the Bigs TV. JHey in the building. My guys in the building. Hold on, man. I know y'all know those two guys. My boy Jesse, G-Dub, Press Box Wag. It's official, man. Those are my guys. They hold me down. I'm holding them down. And that's what it is, man. So I'm going to get up out of here. I got work to do. JHey was official. I appreciate y'all tuning in, rocking with the Bigs as always. And, man, it's been one.
It's the Bigs. It's the Bigs. They calling us the Bigs. It's the Bigs. It's the Bigs. But not because I sag. It's the Bigs. It's the Bigs. They calling us the Bigs. It's the Bigs. It's the Bigs. But not because I sag.